Prospect United Methodist Church. Do we have any guests this morning? I know there's one. Was one back there?
Right here.
Hi. You moved. And your name?
Joe
Hellman. Welcome, and the ushers have a gift for you.
Her and I went to school together, graduated.
Oh, okay. Well, I feel sorry for her, and I'll send her a sympathy card.
In fact, we got together the other day and found out that we're celebrating our 53rd.
Wonderful. 53. Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you. Let us say our mission statement together, please. We are united to love God, to grow in our commitment to Christ, to serve others, and welcome all people.
Thank you.
Please stand for the call to worship. It comes from Psalms 104. When you send forth your spirit, they are created. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works.
Who looks on the earth and in troubles, who touches the mountains and is smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being.
Almighty God, on this day, through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, you reveal the way of eternal life to every race and nation. Pour out this gift anew, that by the preaching of the gospel, your salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
As we continue in prayer, please continue to pray for Tom Zubler, Deborah Mailer, so Bill Bess, who is with us today, looking stylish. So he's for eye sensitivity, he says not to look cool, but I said I think you can do both. Please pray for Ruth Ann Craig, whose mother passed away yesterday morning. Would you please join me in these prayers of the people? Creator and giver of life, make the dry bones of our lives live and breathe again. Holy God, you spoke the world into being. Pour out your spirit to the ends of the earth, that your children may return from exile as citizens of your commonwealth.
And our afflictions may be healed by your word of love and righteousness.
Empowering God, you gave the church the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit. Grant that, gathered and directed by your Spirit, we may confess Christ as Lord.
And combine our diverse gifts with a singular passion to continue His mission in this world until we join in your eternal grace.
Yes, Almighty Father, we lift up all of these prayers to you, the one spoken, the one said in the silence of our hearts. And we lift them up to you in the name of your Son and our Lord, Jesus Christ, as together we pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in
Friends, at this time, we want to recognize those in our congregation who are graduates. You can come on up, Shirley. You know. So, as I say your name, if you're here, please come forward. We have a gift for you, and then briefly, we'd like to know where it is you've graduated from and what your plans are. What's next? Hey, I don't know is an honest answer sometimes. So we'd like to recognize Chandler Castle, Sierra Green, Mallory Haas,
from New Ohio State University. education. Since December, I've been teaching 3-4 preschool at Delaware Christian Church, and come the fall, I will be teaching pre-K at Elgin Elementary School.
Tears of Heart. Amanda Hastings.
I have graduated from River Valley High School, and in November I will be attending the Ohio State Spa School in Columbus, and I will be pursuing my dreams of becoming an esthetician.
Victoria Stanley. Yes. So, friends, would you pray with me as we pray for our graduates? God, we give you thanks for each of these young men and women. We pray that you would pour out your spirit upon them as they close one chapter and open the next. Pray that your spirit and word would light the way forward for them as they pursue the calling that you have placed upon their heart, where their gladness and the world's hunger meet. So God, lead them in a way so that others will see their good deeds, that they'll let their light shine, and they may glorify you, the one who causes us to be fruitful. So we pray just for life abundant as they continue this next chapter of the journey, and pray that others would come to know you through their work, and that they would come to know you more and more in your fullness. We pray this through the strong name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, friends, now at this time, I'm going to invite up Pastor Joe, as he will be talking to us about the Wesley Scholarship Award.
Back in 2004, we started a Wesley Scholarship Fund when the merger of the Wesley United Methodist Church and the Prospect Street United Methodist Church started. And since that time, we've given out many, many scholarships. And because of your contribution of money going into the scholarship fund, we've been able to do that. You see in the bulletin a little envelope. I would encourage you to put something in it. The last time I said that, I got accused because I said, put that extra $20 bill that was put in your back pocket, put in it, but I got a lot of flack from that, so forget that. You can go a little higher if you want to this time. But because of your contribution and the well-taking of the money that we have been through Scott Crawford, who has been investing our money for us, and we have been able to do that. And this year, once again, we never know how many we're going to apply. We were able to honor 6 people with a good scholarship, I think. And they have received a letter already telling them how much it will be and inviting them here now. I'm looking over the congregation to see how many are here, but whatever. So I want, if you could come up here, those, since we brought up the other, Lauren Frank. Amanda Hastings, I gotta bring you up again, Amanda. Kaylin Coobs, I'm sorry, but I couldn't bring her. She's way out in Colorado, right? So that. Haley Criswell, Kelly Criswell, Keely Criswell. Why? Come on, Joe, get with the program. Okay, so these are the 6 scholarships. That we've been.
Brothers and sisters, at this time in our service, we're going to worship the Lord with the giving of our tithes and offerings. And as Pastor Joe reminded us, we will be taking the Wesley Scholarship offering as well through those envelopes. I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward and collect the offering at this time. You all may be seated.
Thank you.
When the day of Pentecost has come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at the sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in a native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all of these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medites, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judah and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own language, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea, all who live in Jerusalem, let it be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you supposed, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through Prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters will prophesy. And your young men shall see visions, your old men shall see dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they will prophesy. And I will show portents of the heavens above and signs on earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.' This is the word of God from long ago for the people of God today."
Thank you.
beautiful job by our bell ensemble. I think that was 3 weeks in a row, and you're finally getting a break. So, well deserved. Friends, today is Pentecost Sunday, and Pentecost originally is the feast that occurs 50 days after the Jewish feast of Passover. So the Israelites were commanded to keep the feast of Passover to commemorate God delivering them from slavery out of Egypt into the promised land. And then they would keep this feast of Passover, 50 days, or I'm sorry, this feast of Pentecost, 50 days after Passover. And so this particular Pentecost occurs 50 days after would have been the most recent Passover, when Jesus was crucified, the Passover lamb who takes away the sin of the world. And after his death, after his resurrection, in which we who put our trust in him pass over from death and sin to life and grace and forgiveness in new covenant with God. This is one of the major feasts for the Jewish people, and so people from all over who adhere to the Jewish faith would travel to Jerusalem specifically for this festival, for this feast, a pilgrim feast. And so that explains why when Molly Lou had to read that dreadful list of all of those places, because people traveled from all over to be in Jerusalem for this feast. It was that important. And what we see God do with this particular Pentecost, he does some extraordinary things. And they're not just things that he did once, but they're things that God continues to do and will continue to do. So I'd just like to talk about a couple of those. The first thing God does, or one of the first things God does at this Pentecost, is God empowers. Everyone say empowers. God empowers through the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. If you'll remember, the way that Jesus is introduced in the Gospels by John the Baptist is he's introduced by John the Baptist saying, I baptize you with water. One is coming after me who is greater, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. And it's now coming to fulfillment in this moment when the Spirit gives them ability. They're filled with the Spirit, and it's tongues of flame rested on each of them. One of the other things that Pentecost began to commemorate in the history of the Israelites was the giving of the law. And so they would celebrate the giving of the Ten Commandments, of Moses going up on the mountain and bringing them down after they had been rescued from slavery. They were now given what they needed to be empowered to live the covenant life, to live as God's redeemed people. And we might not think of commandments as something to celebrate and give thanks for, and yet that's the way the Torah was viewed, as a gift. They were being given what they needed to live the covenant life. And now on this Pentecost, they are given what is needed to live the new covenant life in Christ. The gift of God himself, God's own presence and power, filling them, the Holy Spirit, so that they can live as God's new covenant people, lives of righteousness, of holiness under this new covenant. In Acts chapter 1, before Jesus ascends, he tells the disciples that they will be his witnesses in Jerusalem, which we're seeing in this moment, in Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. He says that they were going to receive power when the Holy Spirit came upon them so that they could be witnesses, and this is what is happening. God empowers through the Holy Spirit. The Spirit gives them the ability. The Spirit empowers them to speak these other languages that there's no other reason they could have been speaking them or would have known them. So God empowers through the Holy Spirit. God also unifies through the Holy Spirit. Everyone say unify.
Unify.
Many see in this story of Pentecost a reversal of the Tower of Babel. So if you go all the way back to the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 11, we're told about how all the people of the earth spoke one common language, and they decided to get together and said, hey, let's build this tower of brick and mortar that reaches the heavens. We can make a name for ourselves. And there's something timeless in that story, isn't there? But you know, God, it says God, you know, kind of takes a peek downstairs to see what's going on, and he says, no way. And he says he confuses their languages so that they can't, you know, embark on this prideful journey together, and he scatters them. It became known as the Tower of Babel. Now, what happens at this Pentecost, though, is a reversal of that. You have all of these people who are from all these different regions and geographies and different backgrounds and nationalities and races and different languages who are now coming together and can understand each other and are unified by God and the power of the Holy Spirit. You also notice the difference of posture. Babel was about building and climbing and making a name for yourself. Pentecost happened when all of the disciples were sitting and waiting on God to move and empower. Much different posture. And now all of these different folks, it's not just that they hear the disciples speaking in different languages, right? You have these disciples, these Galileans, they're from like one tiny pocket of the Roman Empire. Yet you hear all of these languages represented. But it's not just like, you know, one of the apostles is like, donde está la biblioteca? Where's the library? But speaking specifically in a different language about what God has done. And so it's not just the language that's exciting, but it's that God's deeds of power are being proclaimed in these different languages. It's God and God's Spirit that unifies. So God empowers, God unifies, God also gathers. Everyone say gathers. Pentecost, in its originally is a feast of harvest. It was to celebrate the wheat harvest, to give thanks for God's provision, and to continue to thank God and pray for his continued provision so that they might be fed and live. So the wheat harvest, the gathering of the fruit of what God had provided. And instead of the gathering of wheat, we see the gathering of souls into the new covenant community, the church. If you continue to read on in chapter 2, you know, Peter continues to preach for a little bit from where we left off. And then it says that those who welcomed his message were baptized. And that day about 3,000 persons were added. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And so 3,000 souls harvested on this feast of harvest. Now, there's another image that's similar. In the Eastern Church, they have this hymn that talks about how the fishermen, so you know, about half of Jesus' disciples, it seems, were fishermen, fairly simple folks. And then it says, the fishermen were made wise by the Holy Spirit, and through them, God, you gathered the world into your If you remember when Jesus calls Andrew and Peter, James and John, he tells them what? From now on, you will be fishers of men, fishers of people. And we see it come to fruition in this moment here. As 3,000 people are gathered into the net of God's new covenant. One of the last things we see in this is that God keeps his promise. God empowering, God unifying, God gathering. It wasn't just like a spur of the moment thing, but it was something that God had been planning on doing for a long, long time. Hundreds of years before Christ, hundreds of years before this moment, it was predicted in the prophets. And Peter then quotes, the prophet Joel, because, as people see this, it'd be like if someone walked in here and you hear all these languages from around the world, from all of us. It says, some people were really curious what God was doing. Other people were like, I think they've had too much wine. Right? And then Peter stands up, he's like, look, it's 9:00. We haven't had time to get drunk yet, if that's what we were going to do. And then he says, no, actually, this is according to the prophet Joel. This is what God has been promising to do the whole time. He says, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And so you'll notice it's for all people. It's not just Peter and like kind of the leaders, but all of them. It says a tongue of flame rested on each of them. So I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh, and then he's going to empower them. People are going to prophesy and dream dreams and see visions. And because it's all people and all flesh, there's this unifying element to the Holy Spirit. And also, the very last word is that all who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. God gathering people. So all of this is what God had been planning to do all along. It tells us that when God says something and God promises something, even if it takes hundreds of years, God keeps his promises. And so this isn't just something that happened 2,000 years ago, but it's how God works through the Holy Spirit today. And so brothers and sisters, may God, through the Holy Spirit, empower you to be witnesses of the great love and forgiveness God shows us in Jesus Christ. And may God, through the Holy Spirit, unify this group, but also unify you with people that are wildly different from you, because it shows the wildness and beauty of our Creator. And by God empowering you and unifying you, may God then use you to gather more and more people into the net of his love and grace and forgiveness. Amen. Brothers and sisters, thanks be to God. We invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn this morning, "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing."
Thank you.
and sisters. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may you go in peace to love